Let's take a look at a problem that uses the first fundamental theorem of calculus to find the derivative of an integral. Now in this video, I'm assuming that you've already looked at kind of the more basic rules for evaluating this kind of problem, the derivative of integrals. And what I'm going to do is I'm going to take those basic rules and combine them to solve a more complicated problem. Okay, so if you haven't already looked at those basic rules, you should do that first. Okay, so first of all, we're going to have to use the first fundamental theorem of calculus to solve this. So let me quickly just write that on the board so we can reference it. So the first fundamental theorem of calculus says the following. So I'm taking the derivative of an integral. So the derivative of the integral from a to x of f of t dt equals f of x. Okay, so really essentially what's happening here is you're taking the derivative of an antiderivative, right? So you're getting back the original function, but the key is that the bounds here have to be from a, which represents some number, to x. So it has to be in this form. So then our expression, if you look at it, is a little more complicated. So we're simplifying this expression, the derivative with respect to x, of the integral from x to x cubed of the square root of 1 minus t squared dt. Okay, so this square root of 1 minus t squared, that's our function. That's our f of t. If you parallel it to the formula here. And I'm taking the derivative of it. But the problem is that my bounds are not from a to x. They're from x to x cubed. Right? So there's a lot of issues here. And so I'm going to have to kind of do a little manipulation with this. So the first thing you want to do in a problem like this, okay, so the type of problem I'm talking about here is one where you've got variables in both bounds. You're going to want to start by splitting it up so that one of your bounds is a constant. Okay, so what do I mean by that? So let me write this down, and then I'll try to convince you that it makes sense. So I'm going to split this integral part to the integral from x to 0. Plus the integral from 0 to x cubed. So this makes sense, right? So all I'm doing is I'm splitting up this interval, right? So if you were to go from the step I just wrote and I asked you to simplify it, it would make sense that you'd get back to the original form, right? So I'm just splitting the interval from x to x cubed into x to 0 and 0 to x cubed. Right, but overall, I'm still covering the same big interval from x to x cubed. So I can do this. I can split it up like this. And really, you don't even have to split it up at 0. You can split it up at any constant. So this helps out a little bit, right? So now I have at least a constant, right? I don't have a variable as my upper and lower bound. I have this constant 0 in here now. But the first integral here still isn't quite in the right form. Because it's x to 0, and it needs to be 0 to x, right? The number needs to be the lower bound. Well, fixing that's not too bad. All I have to do is flip the limits of integration and add a negative, right? So when you can flip the intervals if you add a negative sign out front. That's one of the properties of definite integrals. So then I have this. All right, and now at this point, we should be down to things that you've already seen how to work with. Okay, so I can think about these things separately. So this first one, well, this is just a classic first fundamental theorem of calculus, right? I have the integral from 0 to x of some function. So that's just going to give me the function out with x's inside. So 1 minus x squared instead of 1 minus t squared, right? Because I'm taking the derivative of this integral. Now, I do need to remember to keep my negative sign out front, that negative coefficient. Okay. Plus, now this one's a little bit stranger, but you should have already seen, hopefully, how to approach this. If you have, instead of just x, a function of x as your upper bound there, you simply take that function and plug it in for t. Right? In other words, instead of plugging in x for t, I'm plugging in x cubed for t. So I have 1 minus x cubed squared under my root. But then there's one more important thing, and this comes from the chain rule. You have to multiply by the derivative of that function. So I need to multiply by 3x squared. All right, so if I clean this up a little bit then, I get negative root of 1 minus x squared plus 3x squared square root of 1 minus x to the sixth. And that is my final answer.